Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to this video. If you are a new viewer, thanks very much for stopping by to check it out. But at the end of the video, don't forget to click that subscribe icon and the bell notification so you'll be advised when I upload new videos in this series as well. Well, today's video is all around the FZ80 or 82 as it's known in the UK. Now, I totally underestimated the take-up of this camera by the photographic marketplace. Now, I guess it was the pricing strategy and the fact that this camera has a phenomenal x60 zoom, which gives the equivalent of something like 1200mm effective focal length in 35mm terms. So, users of this camera were able to capture telephoto shots that were unable to get with things like their smartphones. So, it became a good travel camera. Is it the best camera in the marketplace? Probably not, but it does have a specific use and a lot of people are using things for nature and birding pictures. Judging by some of the photographs I've been sent by people who have bought the 82 and downloaded my FZ82 manual, you can see that they've achieved some quite decent results using the camera once you know how to set it up and get the best results from it. Now, if you use it in the direct IA mode, or the IA Plus mode as it comes as a factory default, there's a great temptation to use this camera all the way to the full zoom. If I just turn this camera on and I record the back of the screen, you can see in the IA mode that we've got currently set. When I zoom, you'll find that we go to the end of the optical zoom at 1200mm, but beyond that, in the light blue zone, is a digital zone which takes us up to 2400mm. Now, it's very tempting to use that, but it does come at a disadvantage with image quality. You can see on screen now some video that I shot with this camera this morning. The air temperature was just 6 degrees, but you can see the effect of air disturbance by heat rising from some of the houses in the foreground. And you can see also the effect of the camera's image stabilization. Because we're using such a long magnification, the camera is actually amplifying the image that's been captured by the lens, and you can see there's a vertical shade going on, and that's due to the optical image stabilization. So we've got two facts there. We've got the atmospheric haze, atmospheric heat, we've got water vapor in the atmosphere, and we've got the camera's optical image stabilizer all working against us to give us a poor result. Now, if you do back away from that 2400mm digital zoom position back to the 1200 optical zoom, then you can get some fairly decent results. What I do recommend you do to get better images out of this camera is forget the IA mode, turn your top mode dial to the P position. And that will give you a almost fully automatic mode if you set the ISO to auto. So then the camera is almost fully automatic and it's not using scene detection, so in some respects you get better images anyway because the camera can't make the mistake of identifying the scene type wrong. So in the P mode, you'll notice that the maximum zoom we can get is 1200mm, which is the end of the optical zoom, which is fine. You can see on screen now a shot that I took up that church, which is a mile distant from my house across the valley there, and it's a fairly reasonable shot. Now, if you're using your smartphone to view these images, they look absolutely beautiful at this sort of resolution. So they're the one taken at 2400mm, and that's the one taken at 1200mm in the P mode. So on your screen, on the iPhone or your tablet, they look fine. It's only when you start to enlarge these on a larger monitor or you want to make larger prints that you find you run into problems with image quality. Well, if I look at the camera, you can see I've got several modifications which I've made, which I think improves its features and functionality. The first one, obviously, is the lens hood. This is a 55mm lens hood, quite a wide angle one, which allows you to use this camera at the 4:3 aspect ratio and without any vignette, even at that 20mm widest angle setting. On the back of the camera, you may notice that I've installed the Nikon DK20 iCup, superglued that to the plastic fascia of that EVF, and that gives me a better totally enclosed EVF when I'm using the EVF. And I do actually recommend you use that. It gives you that third point of suspension to give you that extra stability when you're taking the shot, and it in bright sunlight it's an absolute godsend. And also on the side of the EVF, I've used some blue tack or similar sort of material, so that once I've got that EVF diopter adjustment set right, a dab of blue tack on there stops it from changing. This camera has an awful habit of just changing that diopter. It's the mechanism inside there isn't that good to hold the dowel to the set. So either a bit of black tape or a bit of blue tack will hold that in place, and you won't have the problem of every time you use the EVF that you have to reset the dowel to adjustment. So those are some of the modifications I've made which I think enhance this camera and make it easier to use. Now, in terms of the feature set of this camera, we know it has a terrific zoom range, and it ranges from ultra wide 20 millimeters position, which is far greater than most bridge cameras. Most bridge cameras start around 24 or 25 millimeters. This one gives us that extra 4 millimeters, which is a nice wide shot for landscapes, and it goes out to that incredible times 60 zoom. Now, having a wide zoom range of 20 millimeters all the way up to 1200 millimeters effective focal length at 35 millimeter terms meant some design compromises. Now, we know this lens doesn't have what's called a constant aperture. Unlike the FZ200 or the FZ330, if you've got the aperture set to 2.8, when you zoom all the way to 600 millimeters, it stays at f2.8. Unfortunately, because of the design of this lens, we start to lose the amount of light gathered by the camera as we zoom in. So it starts off at f2.8 at 20 millimeters, but as soon as we get to something like 100 millimeters, we've already lost 2.5 stops of light. We're down to around about f5. When we've zoomed all the way to the 1200 millimeter position, we're already down at f5.9. So we've lost over 2 stops of light. Now that can have dire consequences if we're shooting in low light. It means we've got to use either a lower shutter speed, which can give us subject motion blur, and that's one of the reasons we get poor image quality from this camera. The shutter speed has been too low. And the other one is we either have to raise the ISO, and that gives us the effect of having extra noise in the image. So both of those conspire to give us bad images. So it's true to say that if you want good images, you have to have good light if you're going to use that long telephoto setting. So we're looking at, you know, good bright sunlight or just overcast to give us good image quality. But that's not to say you can't get really decent images in low light, providing you use some sensible precautions in terms of handling the camera. Now, normally I would shoot in aperture priority with all my cameras, as I like to be able to control the amount of depth of field. But because this lens, really, when you start to get over the 200 millimeter position, the range of f-stops available is going from f4.5 down to f8. You don't want to be using f8 because of diffraction limited resolution. You do get a little bit of softening using that f8 f-stop. So our range of f-stops is really 4.5 to something like 7.1. So the range of depth of field doesn't change that much. So for that reason, for this camera, I select S mode. So that's the shutter priority mode. So if we turn the top control dial to give us the S on the screen, you'll find that you can now set your shutter speed. So having selected the fact that I'm using shutter priority mode and I'm using auto ISO, I can go out and take some pictures. The only thing I look at is the focal length of the lens. If I find I'm using, say, 500 millimeters to isolate a plant against its background, I'll set an appropriate shutter speed, and it's normally around about a 3/20th of a second. With the pictures of the woodland plants you've seen on screen now, I was using the full 1200 millimeters effective focal length of this camera to isolate those plants against the background. It meant I was using something like a 320th up to a 500th of a second to capture those, so that the plants, if they were moving in the breeze, were captured without any subject motion blur. The optical image stabilization was stabilizing the fact that I might have been shaking, but we still have to account for any movements in our subject. So if you're shooting sports or anything with any action, use a shutter speed which is the reciprocal of the focal length. So anything over 500 millimeters, you need to be setting a shutter speed of about 1/500th of a second. When we're in the shutter priority mode, the back control dial allows us to change the shutter speed. See on screen now, my shutter speed is 1/60th, the ISO is 80, and the aperture is 2.8. Now, if I were to make the exposure longer by selecting, say, 1/50th of a second, you notice because the ISO is at its lowest value, to maintain the exposure, the camera will now start to adjust the aperture. So it's gone from 2.8 to 3.2. As I lengthen that shutter speed again, you notice that the aperture is changing, and it will go all the way up to f8. And that is the minimum the camera will support. If you needed a longer exposure, then you'd have to use neutral density on the front of this lens to enable the camera to correct the exposure. Conversely, if we go beyond that 60th of a second, the aperture can't increase beyond f2.8, so it has to now increase the ISO. So as we go faster and faster, you notice the ISO keeps going up. You need to keep an eye on that when you're shooting in this mode to make sure that that doesn't creep up to something like 1600, otherwise you start to see a lot of digital noise in your images. Outdoors in sunlight, you're probably not going to encounter that situation. You'll be shooting round about the 640th at ISO 80 to 125, which will give you the best image quality. In terms of metering, I would normally use center weighted, as most of my subjects tend to be within the center of the frame, and it gives me more precise metering in my opinion. By using the Q button, we can step through the facilities that can be changed, and one of them here is the metering on the bottom left hand side. Then use the up cursor key to change the type of metering that we want. So we've got multi-metering mode, center weighted, or spot. The only time I use spot is if I really want to get precise metering. So we're shooting the moon, then I would tend to use spot and then focus the spot on one of the craters, and that will give me the mid-grey tone and I get a much better accurate exposure than using spot or center weighted. But normally I'll be using center weighted for all my metering. So hopefully those hints and tips will allow you to get some better pictures. Use shutter priority mode, set auto ISO in that mode. Keep an eye on your shutter speed to make sure that it matches your focal length so you won't get any subject motion blur. If you find your ISO moves to 1600 or above, then you will have to reduce your shutter speed. Use some mechanical stabilization such as a tripod or additional lights or even flash in some circumstances. Using those methods, you will get better pictures using the FZ80 or 82 camera. Remember, for video, shooting 4K if you can, and then recompress that to 1080p in your editing timeline. So that's it for the video. If you've not already seen my photographic blog, I'll put a link to that in video description below. You'll find lots more information on Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras, on the mirrorless cameras, and now Canon and Fuji cameras as well. So if you've not been there and signed up to my newsletter group, please do so, complete that application form, and that gives me the authority to send you emails. So until the next video, thanks again for watching. Please do take care, and I'll see you all in the next one. Goodbye for now.